All right. Hello, Final Fantasy VI Worlds Collide, and welcome to a very exciting, very high-stakes Moogle's first tournament race between I Am Gar and Poot Scooty. This is a winner's semi-final in the MFT, featuring two very accomplished runners, runners who have made it very far in their first tournament, and the winner of this race goes on to the grand finals, becoming the grandest Moogle of them all. I am Fantastodon, and joining me in the virtual commentator's booth this evening is Saberwolf. Saber, what do we have in store for us this evening?
Oh boy, this is one of those races where the loser doesn't go home, but they can't stay here because I have to go to bed eventually. But but yeah, so Gar, Poot, Scooty, our two best Moogleites, I guess you could say, as you mentioned. So look at this bracket right here. The winner will move on to the finals. And the loser will drop down to the right below there, in the loser's third round there. And they will face... They'll move into the loser's fourth round, actually, rather. And they will face the winner of the Infinius, Kigalas, Golden Shocker, and Cosbots. Now, those matches will be Friday, 9:30, and Saturday at 1 p.m. So the next three nights right here in the World's Collide is going to be pretty busy with some Moogle's First Tournament action. We're trying to get all these races up and running for you.
Yes, indeed. We are down to the final phase of the Moogle's First Tournament, which has been running, I think, since August. So this is the culmination of a very long, very populated race. So certainly our runners tonight and our runners coming up in the next few days have earned their place here in the final phase of the MFT as we see the screens come up for Gar and Poot Scooty. As is standard in race tournaments, race formats these days, we're looking for 6 characters, 9 espers to unlock Kefka's Tower, 9 characters and 12 espers, respectively, to unlock the KT Skip, allowing you to hop to the final phase of Kefka's Tower. There's always the option of performing in the opera. You don't see that too often in a competitive race, but obviously the fans would love to see it, and you will get a random high-tier item, so always cross your fingers for that. But as we've been saying, two runners who have improved dramatically over the course of this multi-month, many, many round Moogle's First Tournament, Gar and Poot Scooty. We will get to see their newfound knowledge on display, their choice of routing, what checks they want to do, and in fact, we're kicking it off right now, and Saber,
my girl,
who we have starting off.
Hey!
Yes, indeed. We've got Sella's Setzer Shadow.
That's a good starting group. My goodness.
I think so, too. Saber, why do you think that's such a good starting group?
Man, I mean, you got so many options to, like, explore and go. Like, I'm gonna pull up my my own tracker here myself just to make sure I get them all. So you got free check with Celeste, you got free check with Shadow, you got free check with Setzer overall. So you got 3 free checks you could do, which is Gao's dad's house, the basement where Celeste is imprisoned, where Locke finds her, and Culligan in the bar or tavern or coffee shop, whatever you want to call it. Where you find Setzer in the World of Ruin. So, pretty good start with those 3 free checks. Plus, you get the double, triple check of Magitech Facility and Floating Continent. I mean, that's pretty darn good.
Yeah, absolutely. A very generous start with those free checks, as you mentioned, as well as some very lucrative sort of multi-check locations with Magitech Factory and Floating Continent. We see Poot Scooty, as a matter of fact, heading straight to South Figaro, ruined South Figaro at that. So presumably we'll check the Figaro basement to check out Celis' first check. Meanwhile, Gar finding an early sniper, a fan favorite weapon, one of my favorite weapons, one of the most satisfying weapons in the game, I think, when it procs that sweet...
Did we actually see the abilities on them? Shoot. I missed the abilities, I think.
I think Celis had natural magic and lore. Okay, someone has lore. Nothing super earth-shattering, but pretty decent characters to start. Obviously, characters with decent equipment pools. Corcellus is one of the ladies of FF6. Has an excellent equipment pool to pull from.
Gar did get a Esper off the sensor check there in the Culligan Tavern. This is an interesting one. You can actually do it in World of Balance or Ruin, I believe.
That is true. Pootscooty not heading into Figaro Basement and instead heading to Returner's Hideout to loot the chests there, as we do see.
Ugh.
Gar is now in Balanced South Figaro.
Ooh, earrings. That's definitely going to be good for Celeste, who's natural magic and lore. And ooh, that's a nice rod there for Pootscooty as well. Gar did get an Esper there. I don't know which one it was. Oh, Starlet. So Starlet Esper there at the Culligan Cafe.
Starlet in the cafe. Dragon Boots in the Returner's Hideout. One of the pieces of a Dragoon build, which I always love to see. Doesn't always happen. Needs a few moving parts to line up to make it happen.
Pretty good throwables there on Pootscooty's screen there. Got some fire shurikens and stuff. Fire shuriken. Dried meat. Lots of dried meat so far. So, probably a cow in the near future.
Dried meats. Yeah. It's always nice to have one in your inventory just to, you know, check that off your to-do list, just in case Gao shows up. But as we watch our runners do this initial round of early game looting, it'll be interesting to see where they go next. Pootscooty seems to be heading back to South Figaro to do the double dip of South Figaro. South Figaro, one of the very few locations in FF6 that repopulates its loot, if that's the right term.
Yeah, that's right.
You can loot both the World of Ruin and World of Balance town, which you cannot do for 99% of locations in this game. Looks like Gar now heading down to the South Figaro basement. We'll get that Sella's check. We'll get quite a few more treasures as well. South Figaro, obviously a very popular early game check for its dense treasures.
Boots Goody passing on the earrings there in the relic shop as Celeste finds a cyan for Gar. We'll find out his abilities a little bit later. Of course, the biggest boss in the game is the menu boss, where you lose most of your time trying to reconfigure your group and armor and such like that. So we'll probably take a look at the what he's got in stock for his characters and their abilities when it's time to tool them up.
Very true. But an early fourth character, and another character with very decent checks. Cyan also coming with a free check. Cyan also coming with a multi-check location. So a pretty generous offering of characters early on here in this winner's semifinal race.
Yeah, and Cyan also has access to a dragon, early dragon fight for some levels. We did find a breakable rod that we could use for that fight. If we could find some Super Balls, and with all these free checks involved, we could definitely propel this race into a very jetty seat here. So
that is true. That does remain to be seen, however, as we will find out where Gar goes next. Has not checked Returner's Hideout, so it's going to head there as we see our runners retracing their steps early on. A question for you, Saberwolf, and maybe for chat as well. Would you take on an early dragon if you could, amass some early rods, early Super Balls? Or is it just too early?
No, I mean, if some of our free checks are offering a lot of espers like that, dragons give 50 points of magic power, or magical learning, I guess you could say. If I get a bunch of espers to learn a bunch of spells and stuff and propel my levels back up to, because you want to have your levels ahead of the curve of how many checks you do, So, and that you could kill multiple birds with one stone, not just two birds with one stone, but a lot of different birds with one stone with that. So I would definitely do a dragon off that, and that would just kick your seat off pretty much the rest of the way. I mean, we're just trying to, right now we're just trying to find some spells to use really for Celeste, and Setzer has pretty good magic power too. Natural magic on Cyan as well there.
Natural magic shock Cyan at that. Love to see the shock command on the character with the lowest magic stat in the game.
Okay, so we have Dance.
Certainly better than nothing.
Dance Setzer, Steel on Shadow, but Shadow has an extremely high magic power base at about 42 now. So definitely better magic power on a Shadow has the best magic power in the group actually right now.
That's true, though I don't think Gar's Shadow is going to be casting a lot of spells. Looks like Gar found a Dragonhorn and slapped the Dragonhorn Dragoon Boots on Shadow. So we've got the makings of a Dragoon build already here just 8 minutes into this seed. And for fans of the jump command like myself, you'll love to see it.
And there's another free Esper that we just mentioned. Palador, a B or A tier Esper. Can get you out of like some jams and Final Kafka with the jump. Kind of jump over the Goner ability.
That's true. I've never pulled it off myself. I'm not a Palador master, as some are. But it can happen. Palador, by the way, does have Bolt 3 on it.
Ooh.
So a very welcome find early on. Any tier 3 magic is going to be extremely powerful throughout the race.
Love Sonata, so it's Tapir, nice to see Spectre, that... El Nino, and I didn't say the last one, so meh on those dances. And that's a floating continent for Gar.
Oh, baby. Gar going right to it.
Yeah.
Floating continent is a very, I think, very fun part of the game. Certainly in the vanilla game, it is one of the, you know, set pieces, one of the critical portions of the game. It is a multi-check. You've got these fixed encounters at the Imperial Air Force. You've got two boss fights.
Nice.
Then a check. Then a boss fight.
Oh, God.
Then a check. Hoovers.
Yeah, so one of the things you could do is try to get some early levels. You want to get a couple of fights in before you fight a boss or something like that. Both of them are doing a way to do it. Gar's fighting the three fights you get before you get the double boss back-to-back on Floating Continent, while Pootskuti went to leader, is fighting the soldiers trying to assault the base, and that's why you don't want to see a Hoover, unfortunately.
That's gonna hurt. Yeah, as you mentioned, the random encounters in the Doma Castle fight are all the same, I believe. So if you find one that's good, you can really grind off it four or five times and earn some early game levels. Unfortunately, the Hoover is not that.
No, so it looks like he's going to go straight for the leader fight here, which is... Oh, God, Guardian too. So that's is probably not going to be a good option right now.
Another pain. Guardian, obviously a KT endgame boss, has a ton of hit points. It's going to take a long time to chew through, and Pootskuti says, I have better things to do. Nopes out of that. It's going to keep Doma Castle's knowledge in his back pocket. He can go back there anytime. It's a very quick check. But it'll be interesting to see where he goes next, as Gar, making great use of Cyan's shock command, is just chewing through these much easier fixed encounters up here in the sky.
I want to also note that...
those crucial early game levels.
I want to also note that Lore Celeste does have Quasar as one of the lore abilities. So... Quasar and Shock is going to do a lot of good damage to these big group fights as we find a Atma Jr. Kind of a... I guess you could say this is French Vanilla on this check.
It's adjacent to Vanilla, whatever that flavor is.
Vanilla
Maybe
Bean.
A light coffee.
Vanilla Bean. How's that?
Yes, Vanilla Bean Atma weapon showing up here in the sky. Dragoon Shadow jumping up and down. Shock Cyan... doing Shock Cyan stuff. Shock, such a powerful early game command, can really do so much work for you. Any, as we all know, any defense-ignoring, non-elemental attack is just useful through every phase of the game. So great to find that, and for free, no less.
Shout out to our tracker, Ceiling Cat, our professional tracker in this community. She says caramel. thank you, Milden, for the raid of two. And shout out to Raiden's Prodigy, first time chat. Thank you.
I'll accept caramel. Hootscooty heading into Daryl's tomb, doing another sets for check. So some early divergence for our runners. Daryl's tomb can be a wee bit confusing early on. I think Hootscooty may have to retrace his steps at some point. But Gar continuing to take on the ultimate weapon in Atma Weapon.
Yeah, one other thing to note about the floating continent checks leading in. You got those three fights, you got this one boss fight, but you actually heal the entire party off of this fight that he just won here, and before you go to the next boss, so he's going to get a full heal off this.
That's true. My favorite full party heal is the falling through midair heal.
Yes.
It is extremely useful.
Free and falling. Sorry. Ooh, tunnel armor.
Tunnel armor. Not the easiest boss in the game because leader exists, but other than that, this boss is going to do big numbers.
That's not the direction I thought you were going to go with that.
Tunnel armor is joke tier in my ranking of the bosses, as we see already going down.
Yeah, it's unfortunately balanced from Vanilla only having a two-person fight with Lockett's less there. So that's probably why it gets a bad rap. And Leader, Leader also, because it's a one-on-one fight. And that is an Edgar sleeping in the crypt there for Setzer, so this will be character number 5. And that's a Doomgaze.
You can take on Doomgaze, uh-oh. Level check.
And we pass.
All right, not a multiple of 5. Let's see that. Doomgaze, unfortunately, also not an easy fight, also has a ton of hit points. So this will be another slow one. Hootscooty running into some rough bosses early on. Meanwhile, Gar already up to 3 Espers.
Yeah, unfortunately it looks like the floating continent was the right path to take. Atma Weapon was a bit of a tougher fight, but still easier than regular Atma. So I guess floating continent was the right way to go here. Yeah, we get the monster.
Well, Pizu paying off for Gar early on. Pootscooty pulling out those Super Balls.
Oh.
Scale cut is going to hurt.
Yeah, this is going to kill. Okay, that's not as bad as I thought it was going to be.
Stays up. Gale cut, not as bad as Wind Slash in the rankings of wind elemental attacks, which are quite rare, but can hurt quite a bit. I think Hootscooty's low enough level that this Doomgaze isn't pulling out super dangerous attacks. Of course, we'll cast Doom, as we already saw. So Poot's got to stay on his toes. Doing all right so far.
Quasar would definitely have been helped here, but Windslash is going to take out. Man, another reset. This is reset number 3 for Hootscooty.
That's tough.
Gailcut is the attack
right outside
the
boss. Is going to warp out. So yeah, has to be said that that's an early setback for Pootscooty, running into 2 brick walls in bosses. I mean, 2 of the hardest bosses in the game just happened to line up that way, and is not following Gar. Still is going his own way. Love to see the divergence in any Worlds Collide seed. Is going to head to the Opera House. Which will, obviously with those fixed encounters, offer an opportunity for some experience as Gar runs into the tentacles.
Yeah, this is another spot that you could take. That's what we're talking about. This the 3 character start of Celeste, Setzer, and Shadow gave you such a diverging path that you could take for leveling and checks and multiple checks and stuff. This is another check Pootscooty is doing with the Opera House, where you can get a couple levels with the rats up in the rafters and to get yourself going in this thing. And he's just in the mindset, it's like, I've reset 3 times. I've got to get my footing somewhere here. So let me try the Opera House. Ceratops, that's a lot easier fight to do. They are immune to Bolt 3, unfortunately, so Bolt 3 is not going to be helpful in this one. But yeah, just trying to get some sort of footing so they can get this seat up and running here for them.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, it must be said, Pootskuti's not that far behind. Obviously, down two early game Espers. Gar looks like to make short work of these tentacles. But still plenty of race left for Pootskuti to get back into things. And of course, Gar is more likely than not to run into those very difficult bosses that we saw Pootskuti run into earlier.
Plus, Pootskuti does have a little bit of advantage of knowing where some things are. Like, he knows where Edgar is right now, being inside the crypt there for Cessor's check. So if he wants to go that route, loop another dragon fight in there, because Edgar does have a dragon fight in the Ancient Cave, he has that route they can pursue. And Edgar has another free check, so...
That is a good point. Meanwhile, Gar, earning his fourth Esper, now making the escape of the now disintegrating floating continent, will not be floating for long.
This is actually my favorite sprite of the game, Ryder.
Hawks in chat saying, "Rip Gastal." I'm kind of on team heck that guy, but you know, for those who want to pour one out for the Empire, feel free. Now's your chance. We're not going to see him again.
I never seem to care because, I mean, you're talking about a guy who created mass genocide across multiple races. I mean, come on.
Yeah, not a good guy.
No.
By any means.
There's that Quasar animation coming out for Celeste. Oh, but unfortunately, hate those monsters that have sneeze, because you don't get reap the benefits of it.
Yeah, woolies can actually be tricky enemies. Of course, they don't stand up to the shock command very well. But then again, nothing does. But Gar is through the fixed encounters.
Ooh,
takes the right route to check that shield, and man, Aegis shield, not bad.
Using those potions, keep it topped off for this last boss fight, which is just the lowly Ultros 4.
Ultros! So
no experience off this, unfortunately.
Our boy, our purple eight-legged friend.
The
Ultros.
The mascot of our, I guess you could say, senior tournament circuit.
That's true. Yes, indeed, the namesake of the Ultros League, which quite a few of our MFT runners are also in. It is a very welcoming league. There are many tiers. You can find, you know, your equivalent competition at any level, and you can have a good time with it. Ultros and Chupon, fun fact, is the only boss encounter in FF6 Worlds Collide that does not reward experience, so no levels up for Gar. But looks like we'll earn another, not character.
Magicite, nice.
Another Esper.
Bahamut.
So that was three Espers for Floating Continent.
Yeah, that'll definitely get them going in this race now with four Espers. Everybody able to get their own Esper for the check. And it looks like he's going to T-Zen Thief to get a possible fifth one here. Getting all those monies from those boss fights. 53,000! No, we're going to try World of Ruin first.
Well, 53,000, and it's not an Esper.
Oh,
the
World
of Balance Thief will let you know if it's a glowing stone or not. So, good knowledge to have there. Meanwhile, Pootskuti running into Rexxol, one of the more annoying bosses in the game, is an extremely frustrating boss in the vanilla game. Here, he doesn't do with the whatever that move is called where he possesses one of your characters.
Fixed dice. Makes...
Dice for sale?
Fixed dice for sale. Weapon shop in the T-Zen weapon shop in World of Balance. With Setzer in the party, you have an automatic user, and it looks like Cyan can use it as well, but with Shock, probably not going to see any use there. So that actually puts Setzer
no
on the
stinger.
Board being
Thank
a good
you,
Dragoon now.
Also, shout out to the very knowledgeable Chatters pointing out there are other bosses that have the opportunity of not awarding experience, like Vargas and Ultros 3. But there are also ways to earn experience by defeating them brute force style. As we see, Gar heading to Doma Castle is about to run into what we know to be Guardian.
Yeah, but he has Bolt 3. He'll be fine off this. He does have the Dragoon set up for Stritzer that I just mentioned. So he'll be good to go on that. So that means Shadow's going to switch over to Magic Mode and Utility Mode for now. Because he's kind of the odd person out right now in the party.
That is true. As Pootskootie is through with the Rexxul battle on center stage, we see who hops down. It is not a character. So both of our runners still at four characters for the moment.
This is my castle. Sorry. There are many others like it, but this is my home.
We'll see how Gar does against the Guardian.
Hmm. And here's that semi-free check. I know somebody in the chat goes, but it costs 1,000 gold. Okay, yeah, technically it does cost 1,000 gold. For an entry fee to ride the Mount Zozo ride.
Hey, if it costs 1,000 gold, it's not free.
Yeah.
Can't call it a free check. It costs money.
Money for nothing.
Quick shout out to Gar using the Steel Command to nab some Force Armor from Guardian. Excellent equipment. So nice to have that in the inventory. Ooh. And as we see that Bolt 3 doing great work, Gar in a much better position to take care of this fight than Pootskootie was in the first go-around.
Yeah, that Bolt 3 doing work going down there.
And down
it
goes.
We know it's not character, though. We know it's not character. So see if we get another Esper off this. That'll be Esper number 6. He'll be like almost home with this.
Yeah, Gar doing great work so far. Not even 24 minutes into this seed.
Nope.
Up to dead check, so a behemoth suit. So,
I mean, it's a decent armor if one of these guys can use it.
Yes, indeed.
Ice 3 on Tritouch.
Well, you love to see Fire 3. That having... And he's got the trifecta. He's got all... Tier 3 elemental spells. You love to see that. That is a huge load off. That means you can hit the majority of boss weaknesses in the game and hit them at maximum strength. So that is great news for Gar.
So Cyan will be the Shocker. Celeste and Shadow will be the Magic Casters with a trio of spells. And then we got Setzer, Fixed Dice, Dragoon, full Dragoon set. So...
sounds like a pretty good setup. Meanwhile, Pootskootie taking on the first dragon of this seed. It is the White Dragon. We'll cast the a few Pearl commands.
I think I did note that Shadow actually had a high magic power roll in this seed, so he's actually no slouch on the casting. So he'll fit in just fine with those extra spells there.
That is a good point. As the White Dragon already goes down, Pootskootie showing some magic power of his own. Those Bolt 3s doing work. This will be a lucrative reward for Pootskootie in terms of experience, magic points, and of course the high tier item, which in this case is another Aegis Shield. So
also getting the Pearl Lance off the White Dragon too.
That's a good point. Also gets the Pearl Lance. Natural vanilla reward of the ice of the vanilla dragon.
Hey, we're rolling now with an Esper for Pootskootie.
Yes, indeed. Pootskootie finding some Espers of his own as Gar runs into Foon Bubba.
Yeah, big old bear of health there.
Yeah. Though it does have the non-elemental attacks. Has a wealth of them. Has Quasar, for my money, one of the coolest looking spells in the game. Got shocks, got those dice.
Raiden Esper.
Raiden Esper for Pootskootie. Very useful Esper.
Hey, Raiden Esper's probably a S-tier item for Kefka's Tower run. As Pootskootie is now going to go for the World of Ruin dream check, where Gar is right now. So we already know first fight's going to be the Pumbaa. So.
Yes, indeed. So after a very divergent first almost half hour here, We are getting a little bit of sync. Obviously, Gar is a check ahead of Poot Scooty. And we will shortly get to take a peek at what our reward is going to look like. It's going to look like a big hairy Yeti.
Yeti train.
So we are actually in Umaro's nightmare.
Oh, boy.
And unsurprisingly, the Yeti is scared of moving machinery.
Ooga, ooga. Yeah, I definitely don't want to see that.
Umaro, perhaps not the most useful party member. But actually, yeah. It does have a pretty convenient check. I think Ruined Narsh is not a bad check by any means. You've got the free heal from the bucket, you've got the dragon, and then with the Tritox spot and Umaro's cave, it's sort of a double check.
Yeah, and, so not that bad. And if you have luck, it's actually a triple check too.
That is a good point. So probably not making it to the party, but not that unwelcome at this stage of the game, though Gar seems to be trying to smother the Yeti.
By the way, before we get into this fight, because we're kind of already know the results of this right now, I'm going to give a shout-out to our runners. Give them a follow. I am Gar and Poot Scooty on their streams that were on Twitch here. So give them some love here after the race here.
Absolutely. Both of our runners, very active, have improved a ton. Really, a credit to Moogle's First Tournament, and more a credit to themselves for how far they have come as runners, putting on a great show for us this evening. I mean, not even half an hour in, and already made a ton of progress making all the right plays so far. So definitely throw them a follow. Also, I love that Chad is coming out of the woodwork to defend Umaro. He's got his uses.
How dare you talk about our Yeti? And Rappa-da-Rappa in the house is going to condemn the entire party before he actually does anything. There we go. Proper English here. One little problem, though. Celeste and Shadow are both geared for just casting spells here. But that doesn't help with Narapa-da-Rapa because he has natural wall up. So anything that will cast like regular spell-wise is going to get reflected on him. However, Lore, being an AoE attack, is going to get around that.
Can't reflect Quasar.
Nope, 3,000 damage hit there. That's going to finish the battle.
So we get a nice sync boss kill for our runners. Poot Scooty taking down Foon Baba, Gar taking down Narapa-da-Rapa.
Flashing yellow and I don't know what color that is on Poot Scooty's side.
Now, of course, it should be pointed out, both of our runners have the chance to become the People's Champion by taking Umaro into the party. Gar choosing not to as yet. And to be honest, probably won't, but...
No.
You know, some of us would love to see it.
And another Esper off that, too. Unicorn. Another A-B tier type Esper.
Yeah, Unicorn also comes in handy in the final battle. I've been finding, I've been using Unicorn more and more just to counteract the train attacks at the end of the game. It can be an extremely useful Esper.
Yeah,
but anyway.
Yeah, paired with Ribbon, it's really good.
5 and 6 here, just under 31 minutes. So making great progress, about to check this monster in a box.
Oh. Celeste able to wield the Behemoth Suit. That's going to jack her magic power up quite considerably here. Good on her for that as he checks the monster chest. Pugs, don't really want this one. I guess it'll be okay with some numbers here.
You know, I don't know if it's the right answer, but I always take the pugs for the chance of a Minerva. Especially when Shadow has Steel.
Yep, I forgot. Shadow had Steel, so this is going to be... You get a Minerva, and you get a Minerva off this fight. Good call.
I believe it is the rare Steel, so it's... Hey, there's one!
Well, we're 2-for-2 right now.
This fight has already paid for itself.
Yeah, then some. So So hopefully Behemoth suit can be worn by somebody else for this Minerva here.
Minerva, for my money, the best armor in the game. Oh, if you can swap out a Behemoth suit for a Minerva, I do that, no question.
Well, Terra and Celeste are, you know, arguably the two main knights characters in the game, and Final Fantasy series always prides itself to having usually the main character to be a knight type person. You go through the series and that's usually the case on most of the games. Maybe not so much maybe Final Fantasy 9, but they're more of a thief, but yeah, they usually get the best armor.
And got a Minerva off the drop as well, so that's two.
Three Minervas.
Was it three? Did he steal two and get another drop?
He stole two and got one on a drop, so yeah, that was Worf.
That's huge.
Did not peek this in World of Balance, so we don't know what's up here. Moogaplex, thanks for the first time chat. Yeah, Minervari? Minervari?
Minervai?
Yeah, Alexander coming out here for Poot Scooty with the Pearl attack against Narappa the Rappa, taking out that boss fight.
That's cool. Well done.
Somebody just learned Ultima naturally.
Wow.
I swear I just saw Ultima pop up on Poot Scooty's side.
I believe that would be Celis, who has natural magic. If so, that is a huge turn of events.
Yeah.
I mean, Gar will get there eventually if he's not there already.
Maybe it's off an Esper that Gar doesn't have. Might be off the Raiden Esper. We don't know.
That is possible. We'll have to keep a sharp eye on that as Gar takes on another dragon. The red dragon this time. Red dragons hate Ice 3, so it's too bad for it that Gar has a bunch of Ice 3. Already, Crack Pow going down.
Do a little dance, kill some dragons.
Another very lucrative fight for Gar.
Poot Scooty with a targeted buy here in the item shop in, looks like, World of Ruin. Fel Figaro getting a bunch of Super Balls and sleeping bags.
Yeah, wanted to grab those bags, grab a sack of those. Gar earning a Valiant Knife from that red dragon.
Not really. We don't really need it, I guess. It'll be good for money, I guess. Nobody really needs it in the group.
Not at the moment, and I don't believe any offering to really supercharge it, but again, another defense ignoring non-elemental attack to have in your back pocket, always good to have, as Poot Scooty searches the skies and finds Mini Master number 24, and Gar finds an actual enemy that belongs in the skies, Air Force.
Yep, hanging on the cliff here. Fortunately, we do have a Bolt 3. We learned very early on the game, so this will be a very fast fight for Gar again. For the Machine boss, all the machine bosses are weak to bolt, so boom boom on both sides. Double boss action again.
Sync boss kills, love to see it. As Celis does a little dance on Poot Scooty's screen.
These two are definitely enjoying this race. I mean, Poot Scooty took a little while to get some footing down, but definitely a trucking now. Oh, but that's a dead check for them, and as for Gar. So the gap extends a little more. Behemoth suit, that's not going to be useful.
Another Behemoth suit.
Gollum for Gar.
Last thing Poot Scooty needs.
Gollum, the S-tier Esper for Kefka.
You always want to see Gollum. So useful in the final battle, as we all know. As Gar heads deeper into Amaro's Cave, he's going to check this monster in a box. Hoping for Katana Soul, getting Spectre.
So, unfortunately for Poot Scooty, he just went to do the leader check again, knowing it's guarding his better spot. However, he just got a Behemoth suit off Search Disguise. He's going to find another one off this fight, too. So, oi.
Yeah, Poot Scooty, unfortunately, spoiled for choice in terms of armor, grabbed that triple Minerva pug battle, can only wear one of them.
Oh, well, I mean, that'd be good money. I mean, he essentially could do, wow, okay, so another Esper number 8 for Gar. He could essentially just go to Auction House right now with all this extra money in the pocket and just get that 9th Esper. And at that point, all he really needs to do is go to what we know is the Crypt Check. But he's going to have to fight a big boss here, the Gog boss, Bolchanice.
It's a spicy one.
Spicy chickens in chat, everybody.
Those are spicy chickens as we take on Poltergeist, the spiciest of statue bosses. Sets are already stopped, so we can expect the blaster follow-up to come in. Sela's pulling out the quasars. Sets are going to shock. I don't see any bio spells. Fun fact, Poltergeist is weak to poison. Can also be stopped. I saw Gar does have the stop spell at his command.
And Celeste...
meanwhile, Puskuti getting revenge on the Guardian. Love to see that.
Down just revenge. That was Ultima for revenge. Golly. So Celeste did earn Ultima. Somebody else learned Ultima now. So that is probably on the Raiden Esper. So that could be a comeback... option for Poot Scooty here.
Yeah, absolutely. Having access to Ultima when your opponent does not is a significant advantage. I expect Poot Scooty to make use of that throughout the rest of the seed. Obviously, there's no spell stronger than Ultima. In a majority of tournament races here at Worlds Collide, we actually ban the Ultima spell because of its power, but we go easy on our Moogles for the Moogles' first tournament, and we'll see if Putsgudi can take advantage of that, as Gar is still in this Poltergeist fight. We see Sela's now stopped. Setzer's flying through the air.
Ooh, two good rolls there. Bit of a long fight here. Not surprised.
Well, you know what? None of the statue bosses are freebies. But Cyan's shock attack gets it done. Stopped Sela's stays up. Spicy Chicken doesn't get to do the blaster combo. So that is a statue boss down for Gar. Always a load off your mind to take care of a statue early on. It means you won't have to see it later. And of course gets to keep that Esper, Gar's 8th Esper. So now just one character... one Esper away from go mode, as Poot Scooty is heading into some new territory for us. Looks like he's heading into Vector and the Magitek factory.
Yeah, this would be a good choice for them. They could probably get, they could get 1, 2, maybe even 3 Espers off this check here. And possibly a character mixed in there too at the end. So definitely a lot of upside here as Gar goes to the Mount Zozo check. That'll give him a dragon, get those some extra levels to get him ready for the Kefka fight. Mount Zozo, unfortunately... no, it gives him an Esper. So that is the Raiden Esper, which has the Ultima on it. So that's... there. Bye-bye, unfortunately, Poot Scooty's a secret weapon here.
And you can tell Gar is... rushing ahead, wants to finish this race, not even checking out these chests that are just barely off the path. Wants to get to the top, wants to close this out, and must be said, has a significant lead right now.
Oh, free Megalixir in the chest in the Magitek facility. That'll be helpful later.
That, absolutely, a very welcome find. Poot Scooty.
White Dragon Aegis Shield is going to be off of this fight for Gar. If he guesses right, and he goes to the crypt and gets Edgar, he could actually unlock Kefka's Tower sub 45 minutes.
That would be a fantastic time.
That's an insane time.
I'm not sure there are very many other places he can go. I mean, he's done...
I mean, yeah, we'll see where he's
going. Well, he hasn't done Match Tech.
He has not done Match Tech.
By the way, shout out to LOL Leader on Pootscooties 3. Lincoln, you'll miss him.
He did Floated Content, he did That Way, he did Leader, he did Dream. He's doing Zozo now. His options
he's
would
got
be...
Cave on the Veldt.
Cave on the Veldt. Did you do Cave on the Veldt?
I don't believe either of our runners have.
No. So he has Cave on the Veldt, Opera House. I believe.
That's true.
Yeah, you could do Opera House as well. Magitek Facility. Opera... which that would be at the ending of the character, so that probably wouldn't be high priority. Or, yeah, the Setzer's Crypt there. Larry Curly and Moe, don't want to see that at the top of the stairs waiting for you.
Three Stooges, don't like to see those. You do like to see on Ultima casting.
Yeah, maybe hopefully Gar will look at this Esper and find the Ultima. Opera House. He already has 9 Espers.
Perhaps he's just shopping?
Maybe. Maybe trying to find some sleeping bags, which are World of Ruin, South Figaro, we know there. That might be what he's looking for.
That's true. Meanwhile, Pootscooty saying, I know there's a strategy to take care of the Stooges, but I don't need it, because I have Shock and Ultima. And it sure looks like it's working. 2 Stooges down, 1 to go. Not going to last long. This is going to be a Magitek check down for Pootscooty. See if Poots can find a way back into this race, as Gar, as you mentioned, looks like he's heading to the Cave on the Veldt.
By the way, that is a times 8 Ultima Learn on that Esper on Raiden.
Nice.
So his jaw probably dropped on that one. It says, okay, I'm in go mode now. But it's got to find the character. This is a peekable check, what we call a peekable check, which means you know what the rewards are going to be before you actually fight the boss. So this is actually a good play here because the crypt is kind of sort of peekable. Kind of throws you into the fight immediately, so you can reset out of it. So both these checks are kind of peekable. This one's a little bit faster than the crypt, so probably good ordering here as you find a lowly Lobo. Sorry, cuz.
Who's a Lobo?
Oh.
Goodbye, Lobo. Meanwhile, Pootscooty heading back to Kolingen. Did he not check the cafe?
Apparently not. Did he not? Which is an Esper, so Starlet, that's number 7 for them.
So again, you know, Pootscooty behind, but not that far behind. Cave in the Veldt is an Esper. Gar says, no thank you, warps out.
Alright, so that's where it'll be a mystery
crypt,
to us.
The crypt was Edgar, and unfortunately yes. Pootscooty was unable to take down, I believe it was Doomgaze. So Pootscooty has that information. Gar does not. And it looks like Gar is heading to everyone's favorite check, the classic, Kefka and Narsh. Oh, no, he heard me. He's saving
first.
Okay.
So you can reset back to the bottom of Narsh instead of resetting at the top of Narsh. Pootscooty is going to give us the Esper check here. We know it's an Esper. So that'll be Esper number 8 for them, as Pootscooty kind of making a comeback here. And like you said, has that knowledge in the back of their head that I know where the character number 6 is.
That's true. We'll be interesting to see what we find here atop the cliffs of Narsh as Gar is making the climb.
Yeah,
obviously, any character puts Gar into go mode.
Gar might be forgetting that he has the crypt check available to him. Probably seeing, thinking that we're locked to Kefka and Narsh, but we are not, as there's a soldier at the top of the hill there.
still has a few other options, though his options are slimming, as we're about to see what boss jumps out of the shadows to attack Poot Scooty, who's just fascinated by that piece of magicite.
There it is. Now he's going. Guard going to be going for character number 6 here off this crypt check for Edgar. Again, we know it's Doomgaze off this as well, so...
Yeah, as long as Gar's party is not a multiple of 5 in levels, should be all right with this. I was going to say, number 128 is weak to Bolt, but of course everything is weak to Ultima. You don't have to worry about that.
Yeah, Ultima is the fix-it-all tool here for the Final Fantasy VI game.
No trouble for Poot Scooty.
Of course, you don't want to see it cast it back at your face by Kefka or Senior Behemoth.
No. Though, of course, the ultimate swag move is to sketch Kefka and Ultima Kefka that way.
Ho, ho, ho.
I think I've seen that once in a Worlds Collide race, and it was so baller.
But there is, but as Real Chatty has kind of alluded to a little bit, there is a limitation to it where it costs 80 magic power every time, 80 magic points every time you use it. So you do run out of resources when you do it that way. Gar is going to find the Master Pug here. He's going to nope out of that.
Yep, going to immediately smoke bomb out of that.
Yeah, no need for a Gradius. Fire Rods, and Phasma, and Ice Rods.
Maybe a little late for that. It would have been nice to find early. Poot Scooty going to grab a few anyway, as Gar does see Edgar sleeps here, but you got to get through Doomgaze first. What are Gar's levels? They are not a multiple of 5. So that's good news. Bad news for Doomgaze is Gar has the Pearl spell, which is going to do some big numbers. Poot Scooty is actually going back in for revenge and is right behind Gar and gonna head back into Daryl's tomb. And Ceiling Cat calling out, Gar did find a Valiant Knife off of the Ice Dragon, or the Ice Dragon location.
Oh, so Poot Scooty already doing the puzzle here and saving. And he warped out, so he already did the puzzle for the tomb already. So all he has to do is just walk in.
That is true. And with that foreknowledge, is checking levels, knows that his party is not a multiple of 5. No worries about that level 5 doom attack. And Poot Scooty is hungering for revenge, and I think revenge tastes like Ultima.
Well, it definitely tastes like Ultima, yeah.
Still in the thick of this battle.
See how much he can catch up here. Again, he already did all the puzzles of the crypt here, and he's doing way more damage with these Ultima attacks.
Yes, indeed. Meanwhile, Gar, with that head start, has taken down Doomgaze, does find Edgar, does unlock Final Kefka. So Gar is our first one with the unlock, as we see Kefka can't believe it. Oh my goodness, pointing at Gar, saying, "Don't you dare come to my tower." But that is exactly where Gar is going.
He needs to find some sleeping bags, I believe, first, because he's still trying to shop for some items here. He's actually going to go to the Opera House where
we're
going to
take out
the dragon here. Yep, give some a little bit more levels here. Also learn the Ultima, because you can learn Ultima off this, too.
That's a very good point. Gar did find that Esper, but hasn't really... It seems like has not earned enough magic points to make use of it the way Poot Scooty has. Poot Scooty actually adding Edgar to the party. A late addition to the team.
Yeah, he's channeling his inner brother. He actually has Blitz. Maybe has more magic power than maybe somebody else does. I mean, I wouldn't add him at this point. I mean, he learned Ultima on all 4 characters. Why would you learn...
It's an unorthodox choice, especially because I believe Setzer already knows Ultima. And,
yeah.
Well... I guess you could say Edgar has all the tools for a Dragoon build. Obviously can naturally equip the Pearl Lance. And slap those two relics on him can be a top-tier Dragoon. Meanwhile, Gar taking down this Storm Dragon. Looks like someone is dancing.
Counterpoint, though, on this. Edgar, by learning Ultima, does give you a fifth character for the Kefka climb. So if you do lose somebody out of the group, you'll have a fifth person in line that also knows Ultima. So actually learning Ultima here is probably not a bad idea, having the fifth person in your back pocket to get through an extra boss fight or even get to the Kefka climb. Getting a Ragnarok off the
Dragon
Sect there.
That is a very, very interesting point. But Gar taking down that dragon. We'll be heading to KT eventually, but for the moment...
She's taking a world tour here.
still doing some shopping. Wants to be well prepared for the KT climb. Obviously, we are here in the Moogle's First Tournament Winners Semifinals. The winner goes on to the finals of the MFT.
There they are.
So Gar doesn't want to leave anything to chance. Finds those sleeping bags. Maybe going to grab a few X-Potions as well along the way.
Oh, there goes the
Selling
Minervas.
Two Minervas.
Getting all those X-Potions for Minervas. Oh my goodness.
I mean, if you can't equip it, might as well sell it. You can't take it with you.
Nope. Can't take it home with you afterwards. You can't give it the terror after you kill Kefka, so... Luna Chimera with the raid, thank you. Edgar Check here
is heading...
Scooty, yeah.
This is a new check, so it'll be exciting to see, and it is not a character, so that is good news for Poots. This is certainly not a quick check, but if it holds the Ninth Esper, it will be well worth it. Meanwhile, at 53 minutes, 50 seconds or so, Gar is about to head into Kefka's Tower, and will have a pretty substantial lead in doing so. Question in chat, is there a quick plus random? There is. I believe it's the standard 30%, but as it happened, no one was able to equip the Minervas. The three Minervas. Only
Celeste,
who can naturally equip.
Yeah, naturally, yeah.
Yeah.
Everybody able to equip the Behemoth suit, though, apparently.
Yeah, Behemoth suit's for everyone. But no one's interested in wearing the Minerva. Their loss. I mean, it's great gear.
Yeah, Celeste is
anyway,
in
we'll
full
what,
go
the...
mode, though, with the Minerva, Ragnarok, Ultima spell, and their spell pool, and Quasar, even, if you really want to go down that route, too. Celeste.
Hey,
is
it's Ultros!
That's a lot of tentacles.
Ultros 1, aka Best Ultros. Get a close up of that big smiling mug of his.
Is he still an octopus with all those tentacles? Because he has more than eight.
He's swimming in spaghetti.
Hey, it's Amanda in the spaghetti. There's the unlock for Rapunzel.
There's the unlock. Mamma mia, says Kefka. I cannot believe you found all of those espers.
By the way,
and
I think
so
he just found an economizer before I did the animation there. I think that one might have been an economizer.
Well, that's great news for someone who likes casting Ultima.
Yeah.
So, things may be tightening up here at the end of the race. We are in endgame right now. Gar is working through Kefka's Tower. Pootscooty will head there before too long. It'll be interesting to see if Poots chooses to take on a dragon, do some shopping. It's actually going to do a bit of Edgar shopping, looks like.
Getting that discount, double check. Now, these runners don't know where the other runner is in the seed. They are running this completely blind, and they don't know where their opponent is. So, 56 minutes in, they know each other is pretty fast. I mean, these two haven't lost in this tournament, so they know the other one's pretty darn good at this flag set. So, taking a dragon here might be an option, because it's still sub 1 hour here, so it might be feeling pretty good still.
That is true, as Gar takes on the first boss of Kefka's Tower, and it is our boy! Yay, Ultros!
Another
Ultros of the seed. Looks like Ultros 3 to me. Now, I know Ultros 1 is weak to Bolt. I don't know if all of them are. Do you know? Are they?
I know that he takes fire damage he does with Bolt.
They're all weak to fire, for sure.
By the way, Putski getting Esper number 10 here with the Phantom Esper off of Edgar's throne.
Hey, why not? You're already there. Takes 2 seconds.
It does raise the levels of the bosses even higher, though.
That is true. But that just means we get to spend more time with Ultras.
Yeah.
Speaking of dragons, however, Gar taking on a dragon here in KT. It is the Dirkdurgan, perhaps the most dangerous of bosses, especially when it drops Landslide on your Setzer.
Does it bring him down, though?
But it does not bring him down. Looks okay. Like this is... Oh, blocks the Honed Tusk as well.
Shadow?
So looking like a pretty good fight for Gar.
Man, that's a dead Dargan. Yeah, Shadow, one of the best blockers in the game, thanks to the best doggo in Final Fantasy, Interceptor.
That is true. Praise Interceptor.
Man, Putskudi flying over Kefka's tower a couple times here. Killing me, Smalls.
Yeah, Putskudi, much like Gar did, is going to try to shop for those last few useful consumables. Looks like he's going to sell the farm to buy some elixirs. And must be said, you can never have too many elixirs.
No, but
Gar
is... But he does have a mega elixir. He doesn't really need that many elixirs, though. You know, I mean, I didn't see any healing, though. I did not see any cure threes, cure twos. I didn't even see any elemental shields where you could cast like an ice three on somebody who's holding an ice shield.
I've not seen any cures. I've not seen any life spells, as you mentioned. No real elemental healing. I think elixirs are useful just throughout the KT climb, which Putskudi is about to embark on, a little less than, I think, 6 minutes behind Gar. Obviously, anything can happen in Kefka's Tower, the final 5.5 or so, doing the final adjustments as Gar is taking care of the three switches, and we will see what this final KT boss gauntlet has in store for our runners. Will we get the Ultros Infinity Gauntlet of all four?
Ooh.
No, we get Doom.
Oh boy. That's unfortunate. Hopefully, don't get frozen off that, which we don't. Oh, but Shadow has Ultima, though.
Sure does. Taste Ultima, Doom.
Quad nines.
And an Interceptor.
Oh.
Block and more quad nines. Oh, poor Doom. If you could ever feel bad for a statue boss.
Yeah, he's in stage two already. Unfortunately, Shadow's out of juice. He ran out of magic points off this.
Well, you still got Jumper Setzer.
Doom not putting up the wall yet, so he's going to get all that magic points back for free. And that should do it right here.
Here comes another big, big blue bubble.
Yeah. And that's probably going to burst Doom here. Yep.
Yes, indeed.
Yeah, this was a juicy seat for Ultimas and fixed ice jumping.
Yeah, no kidding. And Gar making, showcasing that here in this KT boss gauntlet. But will he validate his run? Thank you very much. Enjoy your ribbon. Thank you for validating your run.
Hey, you got your quadro.
Miserable. We did it. We got the quadro. Quadro Ultro. Ultros, thank you for showing up so often. Your reward is lots of pain.
Yeah.
courtesy of Bolt 3 and Fixed Dice. And he exits stage left. But I'm sure we'll see him again in another seed. Meanwhile, Pootscooty onto their first boss, which of course is also Ultras. So we get to spend more time with our purple eight-legged friend.
The ultimate Ultrastic seed that we've ever had.
It is Ultrama. I don't know. Ultramate.
The ultimate seed.
Anyway.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Let's stop over behind.
Sounds good to me. Anyway, checking a peek at Gar's levels. 45 on Setzer and Shadow is a great place to be. That is going to be very powerful for the final battle. Pootscooty, obviously not going to have much of a problem with Ultras, who's just sort of slowly skittering closer and now gets popped by a shock.
Gar having the level advantage of doing all the extra dragons here, while Pootscooty has learned ult on more characters. So that's pretty much what we're seeing. We're seeing a 5-minute head start on Gar's side with a little bit more levels versus Ultima spamming from Pootscooty.
Yes, indeed.
Did Devil Woman just use Grand Train?
Daddy Llama pulling out the big daddy attacks. Grand Train.
Nothing.
That's what happens when you level up bosses, when bosses are scaled to the max. Unfortunately, Big Daddy, not known for his magic attack power.
Well, when you're flying through the air like a kick like that, I mean, you are going to be Grand Training down the tracks doing that, I guess, you know? All those times of chasing people down the tracks like that, bound to happen.
He's always styling. Daddy Llama, the most stylish boss, one of my favorite bosses. I would say more about him, but he's already dead.
But Celeste learns Grand Train now because she does lore.
Hey, it's never too late to learn Grand Train. That's not bad.
Yeah.
A fun, sort of quirk of Gar's positioning.
Oh.
Sending the lore user.
Oh, Luna Camara, you got it. He's the Grand Dada.
Grand Daddy Llama.
Grand Dada. Not the Grand Poobah, the Grand Dada. Oh. I'm going to stop streaming this now.
I'm having a blast. This is fun. We got one more boss on Gar's side. And it's going to be Shock Cyan and the Yeti taking it on. So we will see what our final boss before the final battle has in store for us.
Ooh, Toilet Atma, a vanilla bean Atma here, does get found in this Kekra Tower. This is probably not the last boss you want to see on here. At least
this
one
be,
of them.
Not a pushover. Obviously, Gar does have the tools to do the job, and probably has the health to soak up Atma's attacks. We'll just see if Shock Cyan can get the job done before the party's health runs out as Pootscooty takes on Doom.
But there's a quake coming out for the Atma here.
That could hurt.
Yeah.
That sure does hurt.
Which actually heals Atma at the same time.
That's true. Yeah, Atma absorbs all of the secondary elements. The big three, fire, bolt, ice, do damage. The rest of them don't, and that is a wipe.
Flare
from
Star.
Gar. Toilet Atma flushes Gar's party down the drain, and that is a reset. This may be a total recalibration as well. I don't know if Shock Cyan has the power to get it done.
Okay, Aura Lance is going to help a little bit. Force Arm is going to help a little bit as well. Don't really want to take off the earrings, because that's where a lot of that shock damage is coming from.
Well, it looks like Gar might be thinking about turning Cyan into a jumper, to a dragoon.
Well, he does have that option with the spear. But yeah, the plot definitely thickens now.
Got the horn and the boots.
Who does Pootscooty have going that side?
That is a great question. I wish I had the answer.
It might be Setzer. No, it's not Setzer. It's going to be probably their Shadow Edgar combo.
Well, yeah, looks like Gar just putting the Aura Lance on Cyan for the stats.
Yeah, it's a bit of a stat booster, but I'm really focused on Putzcuti. I think they actually have... If they do have Shadow Edgar going down the Atma path here, learning Ultima on that fifth character Edgar, that's going to pay off for this fight.
That could be extremely helpful as Gar is once more in this HP race. Who will blink first, Atma or Cyan Umaro? Well, Umaro blinks first.
Ooh, popping out the life 3, so even if he goes down, he gives him another chance.
All right.
No! Wombat comes Wombat out! That's an insta-kill!
There's the life 3 coming in clutch. Gar does have those elixirs, right? Or was that Poots?
No, Poots.
I guess I don't think it will matter because... Oh, the miss? The Southern Cross miss?
Yeah, wow. From the Force Armor has a potential chance of evading spells comes through. Nope.
That does not miss. Still another life three. Cyan back on his feet, here for more pain. Speaking of which, Daddy Llama tasting the pain of the big
another
blue bubbles.
Grand Tree just got to reset again.
Yikes. This could be significant roadblock for Gar.
Oh.
And this could turn the whole race on its head. I mean, Putzcuti is chewing through these bosses and is not that far behind. Gar has taken two resets off of Atma. And it's going to have to completely rethink his strategy.
Oh, he did see the Dragonhorn right there.
Shoxbayan is not getting it done quick enough.
He did see the Dragonhorn there in his Relic Inventory, so he could have jumped this to try to mitigate some of the damage here, but... No, he's just going to keep plugging away at this.
I mean, as you mentioned earlier, there's... Really, none of our runners have found any sort of elemental absorption, so there's nothing to mitigate these attacks. As Putzcuti is also about to head into Atma, so we will get sync Atma fights. And this run has suddenly become extremely close.
And I was right, this is Shadow Edgar, both of which have Ultima. So this could be the turning point for Putzcuti.
Yes, indeed. And as much as I love the Yeti, I would rather have two party members that can cast Ultima.
Oh.
For quad nines.
Oh no, we just
got Blitz Edgar.
Okay, well, I thought
he's
Edgar would have learned
it yet.
Ultima by now, but okay. Maybe he hasn't... Oh, you know what? I don't think Edgar has had a boss fight to learn. But it's definitely doing more damage.
As we see... Pulling out the Super Balls, Gar's Cyan is doing a little over 5,000 with Shock, whereas Putzcuti's Shadow is doing quad nines with Ultima. I'm not a math professor.
Kapow for Putzcuti!
Crack pow, and I believe that puts Putzcuti in the lead. Has taken an incredible lead here with this Toilet Atma... roadblock that Gar has run into.
My oh my.
And runs it again down to one hit point. He needs this shock to pay out. He needs this
He's
to be the
gotta
hit.
Kill- yes, he got it!
It is! Crack pow! Oh my god. This is so hype. This race is so close.
Oh, these... I will
this,
say,
this
these...
is massive. I mean,
these
our
MFT
runners are
matches,
neck and neck.
These MFT matches this past week have been insane! Credit to these guys learning this game with their coaching and everything else going into this, like creating such a good show for everybody.
Well, they are certainly putting on a show tonight. This is incredibly hype. Our runners are effectively tied going into the final battle. Poot Scooty doing a little bit of menuing, Gar stepping on the buttons, the beams coming down at 1 hour, 12 minutes flat. And this is going to be a final battle showdown. This is going to come down to...
Oh, no, but he gets the random Moogle Charm off? When he gets Vaporites? Oh,
Moogle
this is
Charm
such a time
right
waster.
End.
Come on.
Luckily, it's Vaporites. It won't take too much. But every second counts now. Gar has a 26-second head start. This is going to come down to levels, to equipment loadout, and to knowledge and execution.
35 seconds.
This is about as...
He went
as
from
close
five
as
and a half. He went to 5.5 minutes down at the start of Kefka's Tower, and is only 35 seconds behind.
This is anyone's race. This is very exciting. As Gar starts off our final battle here at Tier 1, doesn't have any instant death for Long Arm. Does have Ultima.
He does have Raiden. He does have X Zone. So. Those spells were available, so...
Ah. Well, looks like Gar's just going for power overwhelming strats. Just pulling out the blue bubbles as Poot Scooty is now entering the final battle as well.
Celeste is the one with X-Zone for Poot Scooty here. There it is.
Very nice. X-Zone, another very cool-looking attack, especially when the enemies get sucked into it. And that's Long Arm down for Poot Scooty. Gar still has, looks like, all three to take care of. And Gar has taken down Face. Has not taken down Long Arm. Gets vacuum-waved. Is able to take the hit.
Did take Long Arm out with that Fire 3. That Ultima's going to take out the Short Arm, and he's moving on to Tier 2.
All right, Gar moving on up to Tier 2. Arguably the most complicated of the tiers.
Yeah, don't see Mute, unfortunately. And, does have Stop, though. Does
not
have
see Mute.
Kill, but I don't know where the Raiden is. Does have Ice 3.
Always nice to have Ice 3 for the Ice Weak Tiger enemy, which I find is often the one that will derail a run. Tiger can zombify a party, can Northern Cross your party, can be very frustrating. So taking them down early is always a good feeling.
Moogle First,
Scooty now onto Tier 2.
Moogle First tournament, you do have multicast Espers on. So getting that Golem Wall down there to he can cast it again at the next tier. So for those of you Ultra Race runners, you can only use it once.
Play.
Well, here you can use it twice.
Heads up play by Gar as Poot Scooty's now starting Tier 2. And I think this is just going to be kind of a brute force tier. Just... blow big blue bubbles at the enemy until they blow up.
Yep, insta-killing tools there. The only problem you have to watch out for is the quarters from magic and the 10 hits from hits to follow that. If that combo goes off in that order, it might wipe your party out. So you have to be careful, a little bit careful there.
That is true. That can be a very dangerous combo.
Oh!
And one of my favorite lines in this game, you'd best be frozen. Half of Gar's party is now frozen.
And
Tiger
just got brought back to life. Oh, boy.
This is why you mute magic, kids. You can life three your enemies. And it must be said, this is a window for Poot Scooty. Gar is fighting at half strength right now. Poot Scooty already has tools down. Looks like Gar has Tiger down. you know, impossible to know what the health totals of the enemies are, but this is extremely close.
Yeah, unfortunately, we don't have just Fire 1 available, so we can't unthaw Cyan's Shadow here. Here's what I was talking about. Hits is coming down. Getting the blocks from Gollum here. I don't know how much damage is lessening, because the damage is still going through.
I think that's just showing the damage. Gollum is blocking those hits.
Okay. Oh, and there's the death for magic, at least pre-death. Group hug, you don't see that very often. That's the route for lack of healing we had in this game. That's definitely going to help there. And that's a multi-summon too, so he can use this again.
That's true. That is effectively a high-tier cure spell, as synced quarters come out. And I think this is Gar moving on to tier 3 now. Oh, nope. Well, he's about to.
Surely to. That probably just,
magic
yeah.
is done now, casting these dispels.
Cure 2 actually was learned somewhere on both of their Celestes, so must have been naturally learned.
Yes, indeed. Big dice for Gar. Gar heading up about 118.08. The party disappeared, ascending up to tier 3. Pooscooty still dealing with the dregs of tier 2, and we'll see how Gar deals with the very deadly
he's catching
tier
up.
3.
He's catching up. That was a faster tier 2 for Pooscooty.
Yeah, Pootscooty is less than 30 seconds behind, and if you thought Tier 2 was dangerous, Tier 3 can end runs. A double Meteo, a brutal calmness attack. This is a very deadly tier, and a lot of things can happen. Step 1, of course, is taking down Lady in the back. And obviously that Golem summon is going to be crucial to protect against the insta-death calmness attack.
This ultimate coming out from Celeste will definitely take out Girl here in the back. Dueling
Was that both shadows on both players' screens casting Osmos at the same time?
Yeah, it was.
great minds think alike, and these are both great runners, as they have proved it, coming here to the winner's semifinal of the MFT. And this is going to come down to the wire here. Looks like Lady is down on Gar's screen. Pootscooty still dealing with it. Pootscooty pulling out life 3. Because I guess Golem was from the floating continent.
Yes.
So Pootscooty doesn't
Tri-touch.
Have it.
Golem was from the Tri-Touch check, which Pootscooty did not get, so his life 3 is going to be his counter to the calmness protection here.
Right.
Both of them are still casting here.
Yep, sync Ultima, sync Blue Bubbles.
Calmness
There's
out.
The calmness. Easily blocked by Cyan, and Gar is on to tier 4, having surmounted the final battle, ascends into the heavens to take on the one thing standing between him and a place in the grand finals of the Moogle's first tournament. It is the Clown Prince, the Mad Angel, the fool who wears two wings on the same side because he's that wacky. It is Kefka.
What the heck? Two wings on the same side?
Look, they're both on his like right shoulder.
One's smaller than the other one. It's a distance property there.
No, because one's an angel wing and one's a bat wing. I don't know. I leave it up to chat. And the viewers.
Either way, Final Fantasy VI's artwork is stunning, even for back in the day. It's still stunning today.
That is very true. Pootscootie still working through Tier 3 as Gar is bringing out the Ultimas and the Shocks to put the hurt on Final Kefka. Here comes the Fallen One.
Does not have the Megalixir. Megalixir was in the Magitek facility. So you have to do this the hard way for X potions. Which he bought last minute before jumping into Kefka's tower here.
Well, and that shopping trip is paying off now, able to bring his party back up to full health. Here comes Calmness on Pootscootie. Down goes Setzer. Down comes the Life 3. Up comes Setzer. And up comes Pootscootie up into the clouds to take on Kefka. But Gar has a head start as Celis eats a hyperdrive.
Yeah, not having that true Calmness protection and Golem definitely slowed Pootscootie down again. Was nipping at Gar's heels coming off that K2 level, but falling a little behind now.
Yes, indeed. We got the Ultima again. Shadow's high magic power has been a huge boon to both of our runners. Shadow has been basically the main magic caster, sort of the murder ninja instead of murder child of this seed. Obviously, Celis no slouch
Kapow.
Either, and that is Crack Pow, and that is GG. And that is I Am Gar winning this winner's semifinal, advancing to the grand final of the Moogle's First Tournament. Battling for that elusive golden Moogle that I've heard Jones is melting down for our winner.
That's amazing. That would be amazing if that...
I'm completely making that up, but GG to Gar for a fantastic race and a fantastic time. Official time 1:23:27. That is a killer time.
That is a definite. Any time under sub 90 is an amazing time, and it's crazy how both of these runners are going to get that time. It's probably a sub 90 here, depending on what Kefka does. But I think these Ultimas are probably going to do
right
it right
behind.
Here. Yep.
And there is the Crack Pow, and that is GG to Pootscootie, who is still alive in the MFT, is going to be bounced down to the loser's final, but does have a chance for revenge on Gar. And if Pootscootie makes it back to the finals and it's a race similar to this one, we will be very happy to see it, because I think this was a fantastic race. GG to both of our runners. I wonder if we can possibly get them in here for a post-match interview.
Well, we do have Gar in here, the winner, moving on to the winner's bracket final. GG, Gar.
Hey, thanks. What a seed there at the end.
Yeah.
Yeah, had a little scare there with Atma. How are you feeling about that? I think you wiped twice. What were your thoughts there?
I figure eventually I was going to get through it. It was just a matter of how many times I can throw Cyan's poor battered body at the wall before something stuck. Unfortunately I wasn't able to teach him Ultima. I totally forgot to switch the Espers like the third time around, but it's rough when you go up against Atma and your partner for that fight is a Yeti. And then that last El Nino, leaving me with 1 HP. Yeah. Felt good to get through it.
It was a tough one.
Much.
Absolutely. No, you persevered and you pulled out the win. Going back to the beginning of the race, you headed to the floating continent very early on. Was that something that you sort of planned for if you start with Shadow? What was your decision there?
I was kind of mulling it over, because it was between doing that and doing Opera House, the Celeste check. And ultimately, I just decided to do Floating Continent. There's three checks up there, two of which are guaranteed progression. And if I don't do it then, it becomes much harder to do it later on. And I mean, I had no shortage of long choices. I mean, I've got Magitek Facility. I've got what is it? Dome of Dream. So, like, I had places to go, but yeah, just decided to do that. Had some fixed encounters in the beginning to get my levels up, and that was basically all I was thinking at the moment. And then with Cyan Shock, he could carry me through the early game at the very least.
Well, it definitely worked out for you. Outside of the Atma speed bump that you dealt with, were there any particular moments in the race where you felt particularly ahead or behind?
I mean, not really. I was kind of nervous about finding a character for a while. I mean, I think I went up Kefka at Narsh trying to find one, and then remembered that, oh yeah, I could check Setzer and Daryl's Tomb. I have that available to me. And then I lucked out there, so.
Nice. Well, you pulled it through, and with a very impressive time. Saber, I'll throw it over to you.
Well, we got to put Scooty in the racer's lounge now. GG to you. Close race for you.
Yeah, GG Poot Scooty. Holy crap.
You too, buddy. Wow, was it ever. I can't believe that.
Yep, Poot Scooty.
You both had fantastic times.
Yeah, Poot Scooty coming into Kefka's Tower about 5.5 minutes behind, but Garging hung up on that Atma there at the Kefka's God's Boss. Which caught you up, and you took about a 35-second lead right there, I believe.
Crazy.
It was pretty close. It was like around 35 seconds difference between two of you.
Wow, that's insane. That's crazy. That's so great when the races are that close. They're so fun to watch, and it's just so much more exciting when it comes in that close.
But kudos to you for that comeback. Fine. Early on, having a hard time getting that footing. Walk us through the early parts of that game.
Man, yeah, that beginning was rough for me. I made a bunch of just weird mistakes. Like, I didn't really mean to go to South Figaro in the World of Ruin first, but instead of hitting Liftoff at the beginning, I hit World of Ruin, so I figured, I'm here, I might as well do it. So that was a little weird, because I didn't have enough money to buy the Super Balls at the store there, which I could have done if I'd gone to it last, which is what I sort of planned to do. So I had to go back and get them afterwards. And then running into Guardian and then Doomgaze is the first two checks that I decided to do. Was just brutal, you know? Like, two guys you don't want to see that early in the game.
Oh, gosh, yeah.
And,
of HP at that point.
Man, and if I'd gone to Opera House first, you know, the encounters there were giving off sweet experience, so I would have been set if I'd just gone there first, but, you know, sometimes you try to do something a little bit different, because sometimes it pays off, but sometimes it doesn't, you know?
Yeah, for sure.
Well, it was a great race to watch because you guys took such divergent paths. I mean, Poot Scooty, you never went to Floating Continent. Gar, you never went to the Magitek facility. So there was a ton of ground covered and a lot of fun checks for the viewers to watch.
Oh, cool.
And, of course, Poot Scooty, it was great to see you take revenge on those two bosses that gave you trouble early on. Did that feel good for you?
Oh, yeah. I had to make sure, even if they were dead checks, I had to make sure and go and stomp those two because I was upset about the start.
Well, Saber, is there anything you'd like to add?
No, I'm good. GG to both of you for the very, very close action there, I will say.
Yeah, good race, Gar. That was a lot of fun. We should do it again sometime.
Well, you will have a chance to do it again if you keep moving on, though. You definitely, you could reset the bracket even there, Poots.
That's true. I hadn't thought about that. Okay, well, we'll see what happens. Maybe we're due for a rematch.
Hey, bring it.
That was a lot of fun.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Thank you so much. And shout-outs to the Restream crew, Saberwolf, Fantastodon. Thank you both for commentating. Seal and Cat pushing the buttons. Saberwolf, I think you're also pulling double duty, restreaming tonight.
Yeah, oh yeah, but I'm glad when Fantastodon jumps in the booth because he can just rattle off your questions for you guys so we can do more stuff in the background. For instance, updating the brackets there. Fortunately, the graphic at the bottom got a little cut off. I'll fix that in a minute. But, yeah, moving on for Gar and Pootscootie there.
Yeah, thanks very much, guys. I know you guys have dedicated a lot of time to helping out with the restreams and stuff, and that's super awesome. Really appreciate that.
Absolutely. Happy to do it, and if it leads to great races like this, we'll do it a whole lot more. Thanks to both of you runners. GGs, great job.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Have a good evening.
All right, and I think that about does it for us, Saberwolf. I think... this was a heck of a race. I was glad to be a part of it just here in the virtual booth. Want to just echo what Gar and Pootscootie said. Shout out to Saberwolf for doing double duty, talking and making this restream possible. All I do is talk, and it's, you know, all I can do. also shout out to our tremendous tracker, Ceiling Cat, doing the hard work, keeping us informed of what's going on. And GG's again to our runners, and looking forward to more exciting Moogle's First Tournament action as we are closing in on the grand finals.
Yep, we got two. Now, yeah, it doesn't stop there, because we got two loser round two for the loser's bracket, tomorrow night, Friday night, 9:30 Eastern time, right here on FF6 Worlds Collide channel. We're on Twitch. We got Infinius versus Kigalas. And then Saturday night, late night action with Golden Shocker Cosbot. That will be at 10 p.m. Eastern. Again, right here on FF6 Worlds Collide.
Excellent. Hope to see you guys there.
Alrighty. So who's live right now? Who we got live in our community? Infinite Fluff. Not doing anything. That's a new name, huh? Everybody else is doing Ultros League, so in this interest of not spoiling anything, we're probably going to throw it over to this Infinite Fluff. Give him a warm welcome to the world's from the World's Collide community. Let me hop over there. Once again, I am Saberwolf. Thank you again, Vitesodon, for saving me, for being able to do all this extra stuff in the background. Of course, Ceiling Cat lurking in the background doing the tracking. She is the best tracker in the community. And of course, we couldn't do it without our two fantastic runners, Gar and Pootscootie, entertaining us with a very, very close matchup tonight. And I hope you all have a wonderful, wonderful night. Take care, all. Bye-bye.